TDFT can be formulated in linear response, and this is, let's say, the good news brought by the second fundamental paper, the Gross and Cohn paper of 85. And so what is the basis of linear response TDFT? If the independent external potential can be split in two parts, in terms, one static term, representing, for example, the static ionic potential, the potential of the ions of your system, static, plus the perturbation, and only the perturbation is independent. So perturbation that can represent, for example, your the excitation of your system, an electromagnetic field investing the system, or an electron investing the system, and hypothesis of linear response. The time-dependent part is much less than the static part, then you can formulate TDFT as a static DFT plus a linear response to the time-dependent perturbation. Where this hypothesis holds, of course, in all the situation where the perturbation is small with respect to the static ionic field. And so, for example, this condition does not hold, for example, for strong laser perturbations. You cannot use linear response TDFT in the case of strong perturbations, okay? But the vast majority of the spectroscopy techniques introduced by Simo Watari in the first day obey this option. So that you can safely use TDFT in linear response. And how you formulate linear response TDFT? The Runge-Gross theorem. Now you can separate the theorem in two parts. So you can establish a one-to-one correspondence, like in DFT, of the static external potential and the static density, and then this means that together with the Runge-Gross theorem you have also a biunivocal correspondence between the time dependent variation and the time dependent density, you see. Okay, so the Runge-Gross theorem thanks to the Onder-Cohn theorem setup is also this biunivocal, this one-to-one correspondence between the two, the perturbation and the response of the density of the system. Okay. So in the case of linear response DFT, this means that you can run a standard DFT calculation to calculate, to calculate the ground state the static density, the Cohn-Sham eigenvalues and wave functions. And then on top of it, you perform a linear response TDFT calculation to calculate the response of the system, so the variation in the density following the perturbation. And then you can calculate, for example, the polarizability of the system, defined as delta rho over delta v, and from it all the all spectra. Okay. By the Runge, so these two quantities, which are one-to-one related by the Runge-Gross theorem, in linear response DFT, you say that they are also linearly related, so that there exists a relation, linearly relate the perturbation to the density variation. And you, the coefficient of this linear relation, you call it the polarizability, the delta rho over delta d, the response of the system to the perturbation. Of course, you can go also beyond the linear order. So, for example, introducing also a term proportional in delta v squared and proportional source to another coefficient which is key two and so on, key three and so on, going to second and third order. But in this lecture, we will focus just only on the linear response. Second and third order are the matter of the following presentation tomorrow and on Friday. Okay. So this polarizability chi is the fundamental quantity of linear response TDFT calculation, and is also the fundamental quantity associated to a condensed matter system. Let's say it's strongly related to all the observable of your system, all the excited properties of your system, the response of your system. Oh, I mentioned here that you can find the literature different notations. So, for example, delta V is very often indicated also as delta Vx, and so on for other quantities. These are specified in the slides and the notes, if you again, also linear response DFT, like in ordinary TDFT, you can introduce a Consham fictitious non-interacting system. And again, like in DFT, like in full TDFT, the hypothesis, let's say you build this non-Consham non-interacting system under the hypothesis that it's a non-interacting system. So electrons are non-interacting, and they are only interacting with a mean field potential called the Consham potential, okay, containing not only the external potential but also some potentials due to the other electrons, so the Hartree and the exchange correlation part. And you build this system under the hypothesis that the density of the Consham fictitious system is identical to the density of the real system. In the case of linear response, you impose the condition that the density variation is identical, the Consham density variation is identical to the real system density variation, okay, by construction.
What is the meaning of the polarizability here? Are we referring to the magnetic susceptibility, or is a different?
No, here, okay, in this lecture, we are focusing just only to, density correlation function. So this is just only related to charge correlation function. In this lecture, we are not introducing magnetic degrees of spin, degrees of freedom. However, you're right, you can introduce a full polarizability, also including spin degrees of freedom, and so have not only charge density correlation function, but also spin correlation, spin density correlation function. In the last day on Friday, there will be a lecture by Christoph Reisold, rightly introducing spin polarized. Spin polarized polarizability. By the other polarizability, you can describe also magnetic excitation, like for example magnons. Okay. Right? While with this polarizability, which is just only density, you can describe just only plasmons, for example, not magnons. Okay. So you have the polarizability of the real system chi, and you have also here you define, which is the linear relationship between the delta rho Consham is equal to the delta rho of the real system, and delta V Ks, which is different from the dV delta Vx extern of the system, contains farther term due to the other electron, and the linear coefficient of this relation is the Consham polarizability, called different from the polarizability of the real system, okay, is the polarizability of an independent particle system, so a system without the many body electron-electron interaction, okay, responding to a variation of its mean field potential, okay. Again, you can find this quantity indicators as also key S, key Z, key note, and so on. Okay, later. Now, we can write, as in ordinary DFT, the Consham potential variation in free terms, an external one, which is the real external that you apply to the system, an arbitrary term, which is defined as the by this expression, and the variation of the arbitrary potential with respect to the density is exactly the Coulomb potential. You can do yourself taking the arbitrary potential of ordinary VFT and performing these functional derivatives. You land on the Coulomb potential, 1 over r over r prime, okay? And then another term which represents the, let's say, the exchange correlation part of the system, which is defined in a similar way. But in this case, let's say, we don't know, in DFT, we don't know the exact exchange correlation potential of DFT as a function of rho. So here we always require approximation for VXC, and the same also in TDFT. So the functional derivative of the exchange correlation potential is called the exchange correlation kernel. And also on this quantity, we will be obliged to do approximations, okay? While in the case of the arbitrary potential, this expression is X, okay? This for the exchange for the Consham variation, effective total potential. Since this is the response of the system of a an independent particle system where the electrons are non-interacting, you can calculate the Consham polarizability exactly by this expression, which was first found by Adler and Weiser, is the independent particle polarizability of a system where you can write a single particle Hamiltonian, single particle Schrödinger equation. And this is the Fourier transform expression of the Consham polarizability. I leave you as an exercise to find the otherwise expression for the polarizability, this one, starting from the standard DFT Consham equation, static equation, okay? You just only apply a variation to the external potential, to the Consham potential, you vary the Consham equations, and at the end, by using the definition of the Consham polarizability, you have to find the expression that was first found by otherwise, this expression. This expression, if you do it in real space, and this one, if you do in reciprocal space, okay? And also, I leave you as an exercise, this is easier. This is not so easy, but you can manage to find this expression, to derive this expression. While I leave you as an exercise, so this afternoon, if you like, we can see it together, to find this expression relating the true polarizability of the real system, chi, to the Consham polarizability of the fictitious system. Remind you that in the Consham hypothesis, only this quantity, only rho, is identical to the real system, not chi. So this chi has nothing to do with the polarizability of the real system. It's the polarizability of the fictitious system. Easier to calculate, but nothing to do with the real polarizability of the system, okay? However, there is a relation relating, a Dyson equation relation, relating the Consham polarizability to the full polarizability. So this is in a Dyson form, but you can invert the equation this way to have explicitly the polarizability of the real system. Right, you can derive this Dyson equation by imposing these two relations, the relation relating the real density variation to the real polarizability of the system, and the other relating to the Consham polarizability, by replacing in delta V Consham the expression containing the free terms, OK? Okay. So by as an exercise, you try to derive this expression. Okay. And so at the end, sorry. So here, so we have the fundamental quantity of linear response DFT, the polarizability of the real system, so directly associated to the reality, to the physical observable, and how, let's give an example, this quantity is already measurable, so for example, in atoms is the polarizability of an atom, okay? But then also we can associate it to the directory function of a system. So I remind you, let's say the, okay, in this lecture we are only dealing with quantities that are scalar, not tensor. Normally the directory function is a tensor, as Francesco mentioned in the previous talk. And also we are neglecting all magnetic spin, magnetic moment of freedom again. And so by rooting on the, let's say, classical definition of the directory function, which is a relation between the total potential, the external potential relation between the, Francesco wrote D and A, okay, the electric field and the electric displacement. You can, of course, from these quantities, by taking the gradient of this expression, you can land on this expression. So the gradient of A, the electric field A is the electrostatic potential, okay? And classically, the electrostatic potential contains just only the external part and the natural part, the response of the system for a system of classical particle, while for a system of quantum particles, it also contains an excess correlation part. But in the experiment, in the spectroscopy, for example, all the spectroscopy introduced by Simon, you always measure a classical response, so a classical directory function, which we call a test particle, the electric function, which is given by this expression. So these are the microscopic directory function in terms of the polarizability. Vc is again the Coulomb potential, so a well-known form, 1/r/r'. Okay, and this is the quantity that is measurable in the experiment. In particular, not this one, which is the microscopic, the experiment measured the macroscopic, but the link between the microscopic and the macroscopic quantities has been done in the previous lecture by Francesco. Okay. So by the polarizability, you also have all the observables. So again, here I resume what Francesco introduced at you. The microscopic directory function is the inverse of the head, the 0 0 g equals 0/11 of the inverse microscopic directive function, and this quantity is what is observed, for example, in optical absorption experiment, the imaginary part, or in an energy loss function experiment, is minus the imaginary parts of the inverse of the macroscopic directive function, and again, this is not equivalent to taking the 0 0 of the direct matrix in the case where the matrix is not diagonal. So if the matrix is not diagonal, this element is not equal to this element, okay? And it is equal only for homogeneous systems like you have found, okay? And the fact that to take into account the non-diagonal elements of the dielectric matrix means taking into account in the response to an external potential also local inhomogeneities of the due to the system, to the charge of the system, that are able to affect also the long wavelength response the total long wavelength response. So they're even able to affect the dielectric constant, the microscopic dielectric constant defined for Q equals zero and omega equals zero of the system. Okay, so local field effects are important not only for Q different from zero and omega different from zero, but they are affecting also the dielectric constant again in inhomogeneous system. In homogeneous system, there are no local field effects. And you can safely take just only the zero zero element. Okay, so to resume, these are the fundamental equations of TDFT. So starting from the Konsham system, from the DFT Konsham wave functions and energies, you can calculate, these are the occupation numbers, you can calculate the Konsham polarizability after the DFT calculation. Then you plug this Konsham polarizability in the Dyson equation to calculate the real system polarizability chi. And to solve this equation, you need the this equation, ingredient of this equation are the Coulomb potential, the Coulomb 1 over r minus r prime analytic form. And then you need the exchange correlation kernel, FXC, which we do not know exactly. So this is the main unknown of DFT and TDFT2. The exchange correlation potential again, approximations are required, and these approximations are going to affect your final polarizability. Then, once you have the polarizability, you can plug it into the dielectric function expression, and you get directly the absorption and energy loss. Yeah,
but the correlation exchange correlation function that appears in the DFT is, you take it to be the same or you take it to separate?
I mean, for coherence, it would be better to take the same. So for example, if you do an LDA, if you do an LDA calculation, you are going to use an LDA exchange correlation kernel. But as you know, in DFT, now we are doing hybridization with Hartree Fock, so going even outside standard DFT, pure DFT. Because whenever you use an exchange correlation potential, Konsham exchange correlation potential, which is not anymore, no longer a local, so a VXC of only R, but you take it no local, you're going outside DFT. Going to another theory, which is more Hartree Fock like than DFT. So even in TDFT, people is doing whatever can give you the right answer in the cheapest way. Okay, but if you are a purist, of course, you should be coherent using the same approximation. Okay, so this is, let's say, a resume of the scheme of linear response to DFT calculation. You start from Konsham DFT energies and wave functions. You calculate by the hydrolyzed expression the Konsham polarizability. Then by solving the Dyson equation and with an expression, an approximated expression for the exchange correlation kernel, you calculate the real system polarizability. Then the microscopic dielectric function, the microscopic dielectric function to have the observables. And this is exactly the scheme implemented into this code, the dielectric properties code, which is a linear response DFT code in frequency reciprocal space, so not in real space, real time space, on my plane waves basis set. And let's say the such a code is more indicated, so in solid systems, because of plane waves and so periodic boundary condition, while for in isolated systems, so for example molecules, it's better to use a real space formulation, for example a code which is very often used in this case is Octopus. Octopus is a TDFT code in real space, and not only, is also beyond the linear response because it calculates in real space, so the full time evolution. And by Fourier transforming, they can also have spectroscopic answer, while in this code we work directly in the frequency space, so it's more suited to spectroscopy because spectroscopic quantities are quantities measured as a function of some omega frequency, the light on this absorbed on the system, or the energy of an electron, energy loss, and so on. So this code is more suitable for spectroscopic purposes, while Octopus for time-dependent purposes. Okay, so this is what I coming to say. So infinite periodic system, bulk, but also I mentioned also surfaces, why, so 2D, 1D systems. And in this case, it's even more better than the Octopus, because in the Octopus code, of course, it's difficult to represent periodicity in just only one dimension. By why, in the case of Abinit or the DP code, you can do it by using a supercell. Okay, so this is the scheme, the flow diagram of the code. You start from DFT with functions and energies calculated by Abinit code, a DFT code interface. First, you Fourier transform the wave functions to real space. You calculate these quantities, which are, let's say, transition density. You see, if E is equal to J, you will get a quantity which is related to the density, and you sum it's the density of the system. Here, in this case, is the transition density between two different constant states. Then you Fourier transform this rho, so it's the direct product in real space, so this tilde rho. You Fourier transform this tilde rho to the reciprocal space, and by this tilde rho function of G, you can plug them directly for in the otherwise expression for the Kohn-Sham polarizability here. See, and then you by applying the Dyson equation, you pass from the Kohn-Sham polarizability to the real polarizability of the system, and then from it to the dielectric function, macroscopic dielectric function. Okay. Again, here you see the approximation for FXC is here, and while the Kohn-Sham energies appears to build the Kohn-Sham polarizability, the cost of this calculation is to pay is to run FFT, fast Fourier transform of wave functions, inverse and direct in this case. And then here there is the inversion of a matrix. And so you also, there are some tricks also to avoid to pay the cheapest cost, for example, in inversion. Instead to calculate the real polarizability, instead to invert a full matrix, which has a cost of n cube, where n is the size of the matrix, you see that since you need just only the 0,0 element, if you need just only the 0,0 element, and this is the case, because I show you here the formula. Here to calculate the 0,0 epsilon minus one, you need just only the chi 0,0 element. You see here, okay? You don't need the whole chi matrix, okay? So instead of inverting the full matrix that you pay n cube, you solve this linear system for just only one column of chi, not the whole chi. And then you pick up just only the G prime element, the only element that you need. And to solve this linear system, you pay just only n squared instead of n cubed. Okay. Okay, there are some other tricks like this one in the code to solve the problem. And so, and here I resume the fundamental parameters of linear response TDFT calculation and the scaling of the DP code. So, an important parameter is the number, is the cutoff, the number of plane weights used to represent the wave functions, starting wave function. This comes from the DFT code, but in a TDFT code, you can reduce this number because it converges faster than DFT. Then another parameter is the number of bands you are going to use to put this sum. This sum implies occupied and empty bands. So a difference with respect to DFT, you have to deal also with empty bands. And this is a parameter of the calculation. Of course, you should converge your final observable with respect to the number of bands occupied at the, to introduce here. Another important parameter affecting the DFT calculation is the size of the directory matrices, the polarizability matrices. And you pay this factor when you invert the matrix or you solve the linear system. And finally, another parameter that affects the calculation is the number of omega where you want to calculate your spectrum. Okay, these four parameters. Okay, this is given by the problem you are studying. So if you are studying up to 100 electron volt, you have to put enough frequency to encompass your spectrum. These other parameters, you can verify the convergence with respect to these parameters in all your calculations. And for example, in these parameters affect the local field effect, because as Francesco told you, if the system is homogeneous, so there are no local field effects, you just only need the 0,0 element. And so you can put all these matrices, all the parameter and PWMAT to equal to one and save a lot of time, okay? If local field effects are important in systems which are more and more dishomogeneous, these effects are more and more important, your dielectric matrix grow and grow for these systems, okay? And then the number of bands, it depends on the properties you're studying. So for example, in optical properties is sufficient to put here in this sum the double of the occupied bands. Typically, I mean, these are the first electron volts of an optical spectrum. In energy loss, in elastic X-ray scattering spectroscopy, you can arrive to put five times the occupied bands. So the calculation becomes heavier. Okay, so this is the scaling of the code. Okay, not insisting, in any case, you will discover it when using the code. And also, the code is, let's say, you is distributed with an academic license. You can do whatever you like, but commercial and also military users are excluded. For commercial, we can see for military data excluded forever. And okay, so let's go to the last part of the lecture, presenting the result that you can obtain corresponding to the approximation, and so the price you are ready to pay for your calculation. So I introduce now the most used approximation in TDFT, starting from the so-called random phase approximation, RPA. And this approximation consists in neglecting the exchange correlation kernel to curve. So you set it to zero. Now it can seem to you a bold approximation. But I remind you that you are still introducing the R3 part. So in the answer you have to calculate the full polarizability, yeah, you have this kernel, but also the ultra part, this ultra part which is related to the local field effects in Bologna. And so you still are introducing something, the classical part of the response. And also, however, you know that since if you are not a purist, let's say you introduce exchange correlation at the level of DFT. So for example, you can introduce an LDA or a PPE exchange correlation in the static part and neglect exchange correlation to occur in the response. And this is also not so bad approximation, okay? What is this random phase approximation correspond to? This approximation, you can demonstrate that if you, let's say, develop all the expression for TDFT today, and you achieve, and you arrive up to the optical absorption, so the imaginary part of the macroscopic dielectric function, in the RPA without local field effects, this is important. So in this case, you are also neglecting the VC part. This approximation corresponds to the Fermi's golden rule of an independent particle system. So it is exactly what the expression that Simo presented as the first thing you can do when you are calculating a spectrum, an answer to a perturbation. So in this case, I present it for an atom, hydrogen atom, for example, or for a confined system, or for a solid system is analogous. So you have, so in the absorption spectrum, you have an absorption line, like here in hydrogen, the hydrogen atom, corresponding to a possible transition to a possible energy difference. In the case of TDFT, a difference between Concham energies, eigen values, empty and occupied. Okay, so in the case of hydrogen, you have the Balmer, the Lehmann series corresponding to transition between the 1s, 2s, and the other energy. Okay, so corresponding to an energy difference, you place an absorption line here represented by this direct delta. You have an absorption exactly at that energy transition. And what is the weight of this transition is given by the Einstein coefficient. I remind you, quantum mechanical perturbation theory that allows you to calculate the spectrum of the hydrogen atom is the electric dipole operator between the starting and the final wave functions. So between the wave function of the starting level and the landing level. So between an occupied and an empty states. These are the, if this coefficient is zero, so this is electric dipole approximation. If this is coefficient is zero, means that the transition is forbidden. In cases where this coefficient is different from zero, you have a more or less intense line in the spectrum, which means a more or less intense peak of absorption in your absorption spectrum. So RPA is RPA without local field is exactly what experimentalists are doing as a first guess to interpret your experiment, and it's your basic expression in TDFT.
What I don't understand is, maybe it's a language thing, but what is the meaning of random phase? Phase, and what is random? How do you see
the name of this approximation as purely historical reasons? So it was developed in the domain of, I don't remember, catalysis, no, in electrolytes, studying electrolytes. But then, of course, let's say, since the expression is the same in many domains, we use the expression which was invented in this domain. But I mean, all historical reasons. Not, I cannot root it to a well-defined meaning here.
Because I'm not seeing any random phase approximation.
There is none.
It's not a quantum Monte Carlo.
No, I know. Homogeneous neutral gas, because the wave function there has a phase, so we take random phase. That's why we call it random phase approximation.
No, so, but it's even before that. It's not related to any specific quantum system.
Okay.
But even before that.
Okay, so oscillator strength of the are called oscillator strength of the transition. So they can be 0, 1, and if they are 0, the transition is strictly forbidden. So for there are cases in which, for example, in the case of hydrogen atom, you cannot do a transition with a delta L different from 1, 2, for example. You cannot jump from an S to this state. If you calculate this matrix element, you will find 0. Okay. In solid state system, of course, you have you don't have a very well defined orbital character, but very often selection rules that applies in atomic physics have some correspondence also in solid state physics. Okay.
So I found the original paper about the
quantum field approximation.
Yeah. There is something.
Okay, so and then the next approximation is the most used approximation is the so-called adiabatic local density approximation. In this approximation, you take as the exchange correlation kernel the functional derivative of the exchange correlation potential of LDA, the static DFT LDA, and further on you calculate it atomically static, so it means it's calculated atomically equal zero. You can see that this expression for the exchange correlation kernel is local in R space, meaning that there is a delta R of R prime, and it's also static. The meaning of adiabatic is that static does not depend on omega. So it means that this kernel has no memory effects. The response is instantaneous, and the system and the response does not depend on the what happened before, the perturbation before, the evolution of the system before. Okay, both of them are can be critical approximation. In particular, we will see that the locality is quite critical to reproduce, for example, properties like bound excitons, so the state physics, and the non-locality also can be a problem in some cases. And here you have a table resuming what we are going to see in the next as examples of the result you can get by TDFT. And I anticipated you that the performances of TDFT depend on the fact on the approximation, of course, RPA adiabatic LDA, but also on the spectroscopy you are trying to address. If, for example, it is energy loss or optical absorption spectroscopy, and then also it depends if you are studying isolated atoms, molecules, and so on, or infinite periodic solids. And you can see that both approximation performs quite well in isolated systems, almost perfectly for energy loss, with some problems in optical properties, but I mean, still a very good result. In solids, there is a huge difference if you're studying energy loss. In this case, the TDFT results in these two approximations are very good, while in optical properties, unfortunately, these two approximations does not provide very good results in insulator and the semiconductors. In metals, can be still acceptable. Okay. And so let's start analyzing TDFT results in energy loss. And And so here I present, so here energy loss in solids. So these last cases, this case where I told that TDFT works. And in fact, you can see here the experimental spectrum of an energy loss experiment in silicon, the red dots. You can see that it's very simple in this case, the energy loss spectrum. You just only see the so-called plasmon, collective excitation of silicon, more or less at 17 electron volt. It more or less corresponds to the Drude, frequency estimation for this system. So with a shift, with a minor shift, but and here you can see, so the result you can get by an RPA without local field effects. So RPA without local field effects means that you calculate, so to resume, RPA without local field effects means that you use just only kick on sham as the real polarizability. You neglect both FXC and also VC, okay? Then RPA with local field effects, you take into account this term, but you neglect this term. And adiabatic LDA, you take into account the word, okay? And here are the results. So RPA without local field effects. The position of the plasmon is very good. RPA with local field effects. You improve, but the line shift is probably not still improvable. And then TDLDA. And you see, you already see here the importance of local field effects, because this is a, let's say, quite homogeneous system, but it's still an inhomogeneous system. Okay, present some inhomogeneities in the density. And then you can appreciate the importance of local field effects more in the graphite. I remind you that graphite is a layered system. So graphite is the stack of several graphene layers. The system, the electronic density of the system is almost homogeneous in the plane, in the graphene plane, while it presents some discontinuities in the Z direction. In this direction, the direction of stacking. So you can expect that density is homogeneous, the system is homogeneous in the XY direction and inhomogeneous in the Z direction. This means that local field effects are less important in the XY direction and more important in the Z direction. And indeed, here is an energy loss experiment in which the momentum transfer Q is chosen to have an angle with respect to zeta that goes from 90, so it means that the Q, so the, let's say in the energy loss experiment, this is the momentum transfer of the momentum which is transferred to the system by the probe electron. Okay, if this Q is in the XY plane, like here, you can see that the response of the local field effects, the non-local field effects, RPA result are almost coincident. The system is homogeneous in this direction. While if you move to theta going to the Z direction, so to zero, you see that the blue and the black line differ more and more. And you see that the result with local field effect, the black line is more in agreement with the experiment, the red dots, than that one neglecting local field effects. So you are bound to use to introduce local field effects in system where you see that the system undergoes some inhomogeneity. And in the same system, if there is a direction where you suspect that there is an inhomogeneity on density. While if you guess that the system is homogeneous, no local field effect calculation is perfectly fine. Okay. And here you can also see that, there is no difference between the TDLDA with local field effects and the RPA with local field effect, the green curve with respect to the black curve. you see that here you don't see exchange correlation effects so large in this system. But this is because in this system we are sampling the energy loss a different direction, but Q is still almost zero. So it's a negligible momentum transfer, but with a given direction. If you go to other spectroscopy, like for example, in elastic stress scattering spectroscopy at large Q, so in this case, Q is beyond the first Biot zone, it's 1.25111 direction. So always the direction is important, but in this case, I increase the absolute value of the momentum transfer. And you see that in this case, there is difference between the RPA with local field effects and the TDLDA response of the system. And here, exchange correlation effect are needed to restore a good agreement with the experiment. This is a spectrum which has been shown, I think, by Simo in the first day, because it has been measured at the Grenoble synchrotron radiation facility by him. And the other other features that are present in theory and not really in the experiment are due to lifetime effects. So here, for example, this point there is a peak in theory, but in experiment this peak is dumped by lifetime effect. If you introduce them, you can. Okay, so you see that a large, the take home message is that you need local field effects in long direction where the system is inhomogeneous. At Q equals zero, you don't need exchange correlation effects. You can still be with a simple RPA approximation. At Q large Q, you have to introduce also exchange correlation effects to have a better agreement with the spot. Okay, this is the full series of the inelastic stray scattering experiment on silicon by growing Q. So you see here, exchange correlation effects are also important in this case, but grow with and then up to, you arrive to this to large momentum. In this case, you are in the Compton, Simo mentioned it also in the first. This is the situation in which you sample the Compton profile of a system, which is not anymore while in the let's say in the intermediate case you sample you can sample single particle transition plasma. This is a plasmon of silicon. And then in the lowest part, you have single particle transition. Here you sample something which is really the Compton profile, the classical response of the system. Also, I would like to mention that there are some features that are perfectly reproduced by TDFT. Here, for example, this one is the characteristic shape of a Fano resonance. Which is a Fano resonance is defined as the interaction of a discrete excitation and a continuum. Or in this case, a discrete excitation is the plasmon of silicon. I remind you that the plasmon of silicon is more or less at 17-18 electron volt. And the continuum is the continuum of electron hole transitions. And this is the characteristic asymmetric shape of a Fano resonance that can be fit to a Fano profile. And you can see that the TDFT is perfectly able to reproduce this feature, this complex interaction between different excitation, discrete continuum excitation of the system. Okay. Now let's move to optical properties, starting from, let's say, not fully isolated system, but let's say isolated in two direction nanotubes, for example. In this case, you can see that you have an experiment which cannot distinguish. So experiment on nanotubes, but they do not know which chirality of nanotubes are measuring. And we can offer reference spectra For example, this is the answer for the nanotube 5.0. This is the answer for the nanotube 4.2, chirality 4.2, and this is the answer for nanotube 3.3. And so you can interpret the three features you observe in the experiment as due to the different chirality of the experiment. They measured all chiralities, in fact, and so they had a reference spectra for them to understand the experiment. However, in this case, you see that it's only qualitative. We are not able to reproduce quantitatively the optical spectra. For example, in other nanotubes, for example, the BN nanotubes, like the 3.3 nanotubes. And here again, I would like to attract your attention to the importance of local field effects for this inhomogeneous system. In this case, a polarization, light polarized in parallel polarization, so parallel to the tube axis, where the system is more homogeneous. While in this other case, we are sampling the perpendicular polarization to the tube axis. And so in this case, the system is strongly inhomogeneous. You move from zero density to high density to zero density. And you can see that if you calculate the RPA without local field effects, and RPA with local field effects, the spectra are completely different. And for example, if you compare with the experiment, you see that you do not observe nothing up to 4 electron volt, while in the local field response, you start already to observe absorption. So this is a depolarization effect typical of 1D, 2D system. And in order to reproduce this effect, you have to introduce local field effect. And then, of course, also exchange correlation effects also does something on the spectrum. Okay. Same for nanowires. Okay. Then optical absorption in zero dimensional system, for example, in this case, clusters. And here you can see again the experiment in red, the RPA without local field effects in green. Sorry, the experiment is blue, sorry, in this case. The without local field effects in RPA is in green. You can improve the result with the RPA with local field effects. You can improve the result with respect to the experiment. And then also you see an improvement when you introduce also exchange correlation effects. You go a little bit toward the experiment. However, there is still some disagreement, some inaccuracy. I remind you that we are always, so we don't have in TDFT the exact exchange correlation kernel. If we do, if we add this kernel, the theory is in principle exact. So in principle, I would be able to reproduce exactly the experiment, okay? We are limited by the approximations, and TDFT, let's say we don't even add a system like Helium, in which for studying DFT, we know the exact exchange correlation potential. We don't have any system apart model system, simple model systems. And then, okay, before to pass the optical absorption of solid, I would like to say you that in isolated system, it's possible not only to calculate spectra, but also to calculate the electronic excitation directly. Electronic excitation are appearing here in spectra. So every peak corresponds to an electronic excitation. It can be single particle, so an electron hole, or a collective, a plasmon, in the limit of an isolated system. So a collective excitation of all the electrons of a cluster. And this appears as peak in your response functions. And but you can calculate directly this excitation energy by a formalism, which is known in TDFT as Casida's equations. And here I wrote the Casida equation in the square form. So here you get the excitation energies, the eigenvalues of this equation at the poles of chi, so the peak of your response functions, and while the eigenvectors are associated to the oscillator strength, so to the eight of the peaks of a spectrum. The eight of the peak of a spectrum are associated to the oscillator strength, to the eigenvector of these equations. The ingredient of these equations are here written, so there is a you have a matrix in terms of transition index G, and this matrix is composed of one term, diagonal term, which is Kohn-Sham energy differences, and then you have the Hartree exchange correlation kernel here written, which you can calculate by this integral between Kohn-Sham wave functions, the Coulombian, and the given approximation for FX. Okay, so you have all the ingredients to calculate this, and then you diagonalize. Or also another form for this equation, which you are going to see in the presentation, in the lecture on beta sulfide that Francesco is going to give on Friday. You can write the same equation, not for quadratic energies here, squared, but the linear expression for them in this form. And again, the matrix is composed by this diagonal term and a term containing, let's say, the Coulomb and the exchange correlation part. Here I wrote this term in a form which remind the Bethe-Salpeter equation that Francesco is going to introduce, a diagrammatic form in which with respect to BSC, we have the same Coulomb interaction term, three part. What differs is this exchange correlation part. Here we are using an XC kernel, which is much simpler than the Bethe-Salpeter kernel that Francesco is going to use. Okay? And also this term is, you can do the approximation you wish. For example, you can use the adiabatic local density approximation for this kernel. When solving this equation, you get these energies, and you can compare this energy, you can calculate it again. I take again the example of helium atom, where we have the exact solution of the system up to any accuracy. And here you can see the result that you can obtain by using TDFT. Here I present the exact result as in Hilleras. Schrödinger equation solution. This equation is technique that allows us to have the exact solution in the helium atom. Then here I show the exact density functional theory. So I remind you that in this case we know the exact exchange correlation potential of the theory. So we have the exact Kohn-Sham energies and the exact Kohn-Sham energy differences. And here I plot the Kohn-Sham energy differences. So between an empty and an occupied state, the only occupied state is the 1S, the case of helium. And you can see that the exact DFT is already not too bad with respect to the exact result. You see? But I remind you that this is a fictitious system. So in principle, this has nothing to do in particular with the quasi-particle energies, but also with the optical transition energies. These are two different quantities. So for example, the quasi-particle energy, the ionization potential or the HOMO or the LUMO of a molecule is different from the optical gap. The band gap of a system is different from the optical gap of the system. And the Kohn-Sham has nothing to do with neither with the band nor with the optical gap. But you can see if you have to use Kohn-Sham energies, it's better to use them not for quasi-particle band gap, not for quasi-particle for the emission quantities, rather with optical transition. So the Gottschalk differences perform better with optical bandgap than with bandgap in the exact case. While people in DFT is trying a tour de force, an effort to find a functional which is able to reproduce the exact, let's say, close to the experimental band gap. So these hybrids are trying to reproduce the band gap. The exact DFT theory rather give you is closer to the optical gap, which is different. Okay. Then if you apply, so this result is already good with the optical excitation. If you apply TDFT, for example, in LDA, you of course split the singlet and triplet state. This is only just done by the Coulomb part, not the LDA part. So this is, you can get the same result if you do an RPA with local field calculation. You get the same split, but then LDA situate a little bit better the state with respect to the spectrum. Okay, so the split is the local field effect, and the position with respect to the experiment is LDA, exchange correlation approximation. You can see that it's not that bad. Already it's not that bad. The point is that you have to start from exact DFT that normally you don't have. If you start from LDA, unfortunately, the spectrum is completely different. I don't know. No, I didn't report, but you have this shift, 40% shift. A red shift of spectra and of energies due to the fact that you don't know the exact exchange correlation for functional. And in fact, the same happens on solids, so optical properties of solids. If you do a calculation, so here in pulse silicon, if you do a calculation and experiment red dots in RPA without local field effects, with local field effects, and including exchange correlation effects in local density approximation, you see this redshift. Spectra not changing too much, not improving toward the experiment. In particular, you see two main drawbacks of a TD-LDA or other calculations. This redshift of the optical onset, this can be associated to the DFT band gap underestimation of LDA, for example. But then there is another more typical of TDFT drawback, an underestimation of the oscillator strength of the first part of the spectrum, which indicates that the TDLDA is not correctly reproducing excitonic effects. In fact, you will see that in system, I don't know if I have a system. No, okay, I have, at the end I have a system presenting excitonic effects, excitons. In this case, it's just only excitonic effects. So this underestimation is due to the an underestimation of electron-hole interaction effect, a typical underestimation of the low energy part in the semiconductors. And in order to solve this problem, so first you have to solve the DFT-LDA band gap underestimation. For example, if you do GW calculation that provides you a better band gap, you can solve the optical onset. You can, let's say, improve the optical onset of the spectrum, although you are a little bit overestimating, maybe. But in particular, you are still underestimating the oscillator strength of this part. And if you on top of GW, you correct not only the electron-electron interaction effect that corrects the band gap of solid, but you introduce also electron-hole interaction effects between the electron and the hole. In introducing diagram of this kind, interaction between the electron and the hole, you can improve the result in Bethe-Salpeter by this blue curve. And the purpose of TDFT, of the TDFT kernel, is to reproduce both these effects which are unable, which LDA is unable to. You see. So these are the drawbacks of TD-LDA, and when you see such a situation, like the question that was asked by you in the interval is, of course, if TDFT, TD-LDA is already providing a good answer, good response in a given system. So for example, you have seen in clusters, you stop there. In cases like silicon, of course, in order to have a good good response function, you have to move to other approaches, because TD-LDA, this approximation is not enough for you to be satisfied to reproduce the physical situation. Okay.
Then I reconnect to a question that was raised in the chat. It was raised quite some time ago, but now it becomes pertinent. So what about other functionals? For example, we have seen that hybrids function in DFT works quite better to reproduce the gap. What about the time-dependent version, if it exists, for this kind, for example, the HSE? That was the person, the HSE, if it is time-dependent, what would be the result?
Okay, so in the key, I would say that these functionals can correct this problem. So a functional that tries to reproduce a better band gap in solids, like the band gap, the GW band gap, which is in good agreement with the experiment, you will have a spectrum like this. To have the further increase in the electron hole interaction effect, the excitonic effect, so the correct reproduction of the oscillator strength in the lowest part of the spectrum is a different matter. And so these functionals are tuned to reproduce the band gap of the system, not to reproduce also this part. So can be a really fortuitous case if they can reproduce also this part. But also I would say that this approach is not correct to use hybrid functionals in the, if you are a DFT purist, because the DFT, pure DFT, extra DFT is not giving you the band gap, the homolumo gap, it's giving you the optical gap. The homolumo gap is okay. In this case, is the homolumo gap in this case, I don't remember in art is so yes, the homolumo gap in the helium atom is 25 electron volt. So 5 electron volts there. And so this means that if you buy the hybrids HSC or the PBH and so on, you can reproduce the band gap that in helium is at 25, but you miss completely the optical excitation, so the optical spectrum, the optical gap. Okay, so to conclude, because we have just only 15 minutes, I mentioned, so the I would like to say, to show you where TD-LDA is failing miserably. So there are also these cases. In the case of large band gap insulator presenting strongly bound excitons, here the case of solid argon. The case of solid argon is really the case of a system in which you have a large band gap. In the case of argon, it's 14 electron volts. And then you have a series of bound excitons, so large band gap, 14 electron volt, and the series of bound exciton situated in the middle of the band gap, discrete excitation that you see in the band gap. And in the experiment, indeed, you see this peak. So the band gap is at 14 electron volts. The band gap that you measure in photoemission is 14 electron volt. And in the middle of the band gap, you see in optics at least 3, even 4 peaks, which represent the full excitonic series. So you have to imagine the exciton exactly like an hydrogen atom, an exciton is a bound state of a hole and an electron. And you can imagine this system like an hydrogen atom. So can solve the Schrödinger equation of hydrogen atom, and you can observe a Balmer series. So the energy goes like 1 over n squared. So n equal 1, n equal 2, n equal 3. And you have the hydrogen atom, you have this series with the ground state, which is 1 ring back. Okay. In the exciton, the only difference is that the hole, while in the hydrogen atom, you have the proton and the electron, which are orbiting in the vacuum. Here, the hole and the electrons are orbiting in the middle of a solid state system, so separated by several lattice parameters, can be separated by several lattice. And so they are not interacting by a pure bare Coulomb interaction, they are interacting by a screened Coulomb interaction. The other electrons are screening their interaction, so that you can expect that this series is not perfectly 1 over n squared like the hydrogen, but a factor deviation due to the screening, to the fact that the electrons, that are electron and hole that are far away, see each other less directly, are screened more and more, until a point where they do not see each other because of the screening. So you can see that this series is modified. And in fact, let's say this is a, you can see an enormous hydrogenic series, 1 over n squared plus a correction, which is due to the screening and to the fact that we are in a solid state system. You can see that in TDFT, LDA, RPA, or no matter which simple approximation, you have a flat, flat spectrum. You are completely unable to reproduce excitons in this system. So this, the local approximation of LDA is not at all able to provide you an excitonic series, a bound exciton in a system presenting these excitons. In order to correct this problem, you can go to Bethe-Salpeter, or also we have also worked within the European Theoretical Spectroscopy Facility to new approximation beyond adiabatic LDA that can able to reproduce this series. And I present here some without entering into the details. In the notes, you can find references that can introduce these new approximations. Three of them were able to reproduce, not only three of them, there are other one, but here, let's say I just received to three of them. In particular, I just only introduced this long range contribution only, which is very simple. The other are much more complex. In the long range contribution only, you let's say you improve the local density approximation kernel, which is a local kernel, by introducing a long range contribution. This is, let's say, a non-local contribution. So in this case, the kernel depends on R and R prime, and not on, just only on R, like the LDA local kernel. And so this means that in a reciprocal space, the Fourier transform of a Coulombian, 1 over R minus R prime is 1 over Q squared. You have a term which behaves like this, a 1 over Q squared a long range contribution, which is absent in the local density kernel. And then here you let's say you put an adjustable coefficient that can be very strongly related to the screening, because as you have told you, in the exciton, the screening is playing a role. And if you plug this kernel into a TDFT calculation, you can see here the black line compared, for example, to the better result, the Salpeter result in the experiment. You can reproduce this, let's say, oscillator strength increase, excitonic effects at the lowest energies, and also, of course, you can reproduce also the the correct optical offset of the system. And however, this approximation does not work very well for a system with bound excitons. For system with bound excitons, like in the case of the solid argon, you have to implement more, let's say, more complex approximation like this nanoquanta kernel. And you can see that in the case of the nanoquanta kernel, you can reproduce the excitonic series exactly like the Bethe-Salpeter calculation. And but however, this is something that is going to be introduced in the Bethe-Salpeter lecture by Francesco. And I would like to stop here. So as conclusion, so perfectly in time, Francesco.
Yeah.
So as a take home message, I would like that you keep in mind that TDFT is a valid, is an in principle exact theory to calculate from first principle excited state properties, so excitations and spectroscopy. Of course, we don't know the exact exchange correlation kernel. In the case of TDFT, is the kernel, the potential of the theory. And we must resort to approximation. And so we have an approximated answer to excitations and spectroscopy, which can be good or bad, depending on the approximation you have chosen, the system you are studying, and the optical and the spectroscopy you are focusing, you are studying, you are dealing with. And I remind you that, for example, RPA with local field effects is able to reproduce energy loss spectra at Q equals zero. And you can remove, you can also neglect the local field effects for homogeneous system. But I mean, this is a very rare situation. Then you have, you need to introduce exact correlation effects upon RPA on hills and, for example, in elastic, at high Q, like a transferred momentum. So in this case, exchange correlation effects matter. TDLDA seems also to improve upon RPA in optical spectra in finite systems. So it needs clusters, atoms, molecules. In molecules in chemistry, TDLDA is a very much used, often used approach. For solids, and optical properties, unfortunately, none of these approximation works fine to reproduce in particular correct optical gap and correct oscillator strength of the lowest energy part, in particular excitons, bound excitons of the system. In order to describe this system, you must resort to more refined kernel beyond the LDA. And I presented the result of, without entering too much into details, this local range contribution only in nanoquanta, just to show you that TDFT keeps in principle exact theory for these quantities. It's up to you, the research of the next years, you are the youngest, so the future is in your hands, to search better approximation for this exchange correlation kernel. Simpler also, because also we need simplicity. We cannot, the calculation must be affordable with the computing power, which should be much larger in the future, but still affordable. And so this is the research line that you can be interested in your next years, in your future. And so among the perspective, I also put this one, so improve the algorithm, but in particular, find a better expression for the kernel, simplifying what we have done so far. So I stop here, and I just want to, before to question, of course, session question is open, but I would like to also for this afternoon tutorial, I invite you to connect to so the web page. Can you write it on the blackboard because it's not written there. So atsf.polytechnic.fr and then? Okay, you write it in on the chat. On this link, you will have the tutorials, the DP code, as well as the XC code, the tutorial you are going to do this afternoon, exercise this afternoon.
Yeah, this will be also on the whiteboard in the other room. But anyway, this is the website where you have all the exercises, so it's easy to click there and follow the instructions.
So if you have a further question, yeah.
Maybe I'm missing something.
Just a moment.
No, I expected that she raises the voice. So the
voice.
I tried.
Okay.
Maybe I'm missing something there, but about the question that was before raised about hybrid functionals and TDDFT, because you said that TDDFT is related more to the optical gap, differently from the eye network. But I've seen like another lot of paper using TDDFT with like the link or under every function like that to see the optical gap of molecules and the assertion spectrum. Yes, of the molecules.
Yes, this is the other question.
It's just about comment about that.
Okay. So I precise a little bit more what is happening in this case. So we have just only one case where we have this exact solution, and this is the helium atom. And if you run these calculations on the helium atom, I also presented the exact this is the Homo-Lumo gap. So the optical gap and the Homo-Lumo gap. I could have presented them in the same slide. Okay, they are the 20 slides separated. So you see that in this case we don't have the exact Homo-Lumo gap because we can calculate the exact Homo but not the exact Lumo, because the exact Lumo means calculating a system with free electrons, which is not possible. Well, the system with two electrons, you can solve the Schrödinger equation in the Hiller-Ras way. However, we are sure that this Homo-Lumo gap in helium is greater than 24.5 electron volt. And you can see that Artifok is in good agreement with the experiment. GW is in good agreement with the experiment. And Artifok also is not performing that bad. Okay? Then you have the Homo-Lumo gap, as you mentioned, in exact DFT. You see that there is a 5 electron volt shift. This is exact DFT. Really, you have to believe that this theory exists and is unique mathematically. And you have this is the result. And this is the result of DFT, which you see is even more underestimated, 40% underestimation of the band gap. Now, why B3LIP or HSC or PBAH, what are they doing? They are trying to distort the EXA theory. So this is what I say, hybrid is not anymore DFT. Don't call it the DFT, because
it's a self-energy approximation.
Yes, not even a self-energy study. So it's an Artifok, generalized Artifok. Call it the generalized Artifok. In fact, you have an exchange which is the Artifok exchange. If in your approximation, for example, in PBH, if you put to zero the correlation part, you don't see any difference. What matters is just only the alpha in front of the exchange. This is do the last big job. The other part, and by these approximations, so these are they distort the original purpose of DFT. So exa DFT gives this. In disagreement, not in principle. Why? By this hybrid state, try to put the theory there. And so they are losing something. In particular, what they are losing, the quantities that are exact DFT. So for example, it is not given that the exact density by this distortion is the that one of the hybrids. Now, you see, so From this, you try to put it. Now, let's take the optical gap of this system. The optical gap is the last figure. The optical gap can be considered the first optical transition. So the optical gap is 18 electron volt. And you say that, so the exact Kohn-Sham gap is, as before, 20 point something, close to 19 point something, you see. So by the hybrids, they are distorting this exact DFT Kohn-Sham gap there at 25, where I remind you is the experimental, the exact one, they are bringing it there at that position, while in the exact theory, in the pure theory, is very close to the optical gap. So I think that people try to develop DFT in this direction, so try to go toward the band gap instead to go to the optical gap. They get far and far away from exa-DFT toward a theory which has nothing more to say, to see with exa-DFT, which is, let's say, as I told you, rather more an artifact generalized approach. I mean, this is a, so this point of view, I would work rather to a theory, to a DFT and TDFT theory, which is way here, from NDA to go there, not to go there. Because I'm a purist, like what's your name, Riccardo?
Thank you.
Any other question? Also from people online, we do not forget you. So, Guman, have you a question? He's not anymore there.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a question. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, on the previous slide before this, we are showing the artifact and
this one?
No, no.
Which
there
one?
Was that table that you used to explain the DFT and the gas. Yes, when you have DFT cannot.
Ah, the properties that DFT cannot, okay. This one.
Yes. So does it mean in this case, we can say that the artifact is far better to the DFT?
No, sorry.
What
no, no, it's not better. No, it's not better.
So what I said is okay. So what I was like, I was looking at the experiment, so and the other values. So then I see how close the artifact was to the experiment from the exact DFT. So does it mean now that in the case like this, it's better to use artifact?
Yes, of course. Why? Good question. So in artifact, I remind you, Gianmarco talk, in artifact, there is a Kottmann theorem stating that artifact energies can be interpreted as electron removal energies of the system. So the physical interpretation of artifact energy is exactly as you can interpret the last one occupied one as the HOMO, the first unoccupied one as the LUMO. There is, let's say, it's possible this physical association, this physical interpretation. Why, in the case of DFT, even exact DFT, these are the eigenvalues of a fictitious system, the Kohn-Sham fictitious system, which has nothing to do with real physics because it's a non-interacting physics. And this system has been introduced just only as an auxiliary system to calculate the quantity that by construction are identical with the real system. And these quantities are just only the electronic density and the total ground state energy. These are the only quantities that you can predict by using the Kohn-Sham system, okay? Total energy and electronic density, not the Omolungo gap, not the band gap, okay? The exact response, the exact Omolungo gap of the exact DFT, in case you know, does not correspond to the reality. Why? As I show you in the next, in the previous slide, the exact DFT total energy corresponds to the last digit to the exact result. You see?
Yes.
So there are quantities that you are allowed to search within DFT and within Kohn-Sham DFT. Other quantities like the Omolungo gap, I mean, you can use, what I say here is that you can use DFT to predict this property. For example, you see in the literature plenty of band plot using DFT, even though this is not interpretable. If it works, fine. So you save a lot of time, because in order to calculate this quantity in many body approaches, it's you waste a lot of computing time. So if it works, you stop there. But if it doesn't work, don't blame DFT. Because you have to know that DFT gives you the right answer just only on the this. Don't blame it. So don't say, DFT is a disaster. It's not a disaster. And the demonstration of it is that DFT is one of the most used theory physics. Okay, so this is the reason why DFT is.
Okay, just to also finish the comment, because Valerio talked about this this Omolungo gap in terms of the Kohn-Sham exact eigenvalues. You could also trick it and say you calculate the helium atom total energy. That's exact in this state, right? Then you calculate the atom with one electron less, and so you calculate the home again as a difference of total energies. Then you calculate the helium atom with an electron in addition, and so you can calculate by energy total energy difference the Lummo state. And then by doing all this calculation, all exact, you do the Lummo minus Lummo, or the Lummo minus Lummo, you obtain the exact result in DFT, which is not Kohn-Sham. It's a total energy difference. So it's a lot of calculation, but then you obtain the exact result again. You obtain the same, the next slide. Yeah, you obtain the exp there in DFT, because it's exact. But it's exact for what? For total energy, for the density, not for the eigenvalues. And the eigenvalues are eigenvalues.
And you can do it for energies only on isolated systems, not in solids. Because there was a question during the interval by somebody, you can use, so you can calculate the total energy for the system with n plus one, n minus one, and calculate the Omolungo gap by the formula that Gianmarco presented in his slides. And not in solids, because in solid it's ill-defined how to add one electron more to the system. You are running a calculation in an elementary cell with periodic boundary condition. So if you add an electron to this cell, it means that you add infinite electrons to the system. Every cell is going to have an electron more. While in the isolated system, this is possible and gives you a good answer for the Omolungo.
I have a question.
What
you say that solid particles have hybrids are more close to a modified Hartree-Fock instead of the DFT. But like Hartree-Fock is an infield theory, right? And even using hybrid functionals, you still use the density, so it's not a main field theory. So why do you think it's using hybrid is more close to Hartree-Fock than a modified DFT?
But in reality, the hybrids are used, most of them are using wave functions, not density. So are functional of.
Why is the dark fog is a mean field?
No,
there's no actual fog potential.
Because the electrons.
It's non-local there. So the exact exchange is non-local potential. So how would you call that
No, but the Hartree-Fock is a meter, not the DFT.
No, Hartree-Fock. When you have Hartree-Fock, as I showed yesterday, your Vx is a non-local operator.
But the electron sees the electron see the other electrons as a field.
In the Hartree approximation, not in the Hartree-Fock.
Of course, there is people calling Hartree-Fock mean-field theory improperly. As Gianmarco said, it's improper. This because a mean field is really a local potential. It's a V of R, not a sigma of R, R prime, like the exchange operator of Hartree-Fock, no? However, without, let's say, without, I answer to your question, so why I call it, but I mean, the hybrids are not functional of density. Most of them are not functional of the density, no? They are using an Hartree-Fock exchange operator, and the Hartree-Fock exchange operator contains Hartree-Fock wave functions, not Hartree-Fock density, no? Can we write the exchange operator?
But the hybrids, they use the wave functions from DFT, right? They
Sorry?
Don't use the Hartree-Fock wave function.
It's a hybrid. So if you put alpha equal one
wave function, not the density. That's the point that Valeria is making.
Yeah.
Wherever it's Hartree-Fock or VFD, it's the wave function, not the density.
And
you don't have an explicit function of the density.
Yeah, in hybrids. No, but I'm not an expert. Yeah. You know what the there is no.
You know.
There is no. Okay. So in this let's say. Why did they can't see anymore? You know, all out.
They can also move the camera. I don't know what you mean.
No, I'm bright to you. They can see. Okay, so in the hybrids, you cannot write the XC functional as a functional for all, but it's always a functional for all the. Hybrids I know is a function of the orbitals. Then you say, okay, but if you put here Concham, but it is DFT and not Hartree-Fock, because you would say this is Hartree-Fock if you put, but I mean, you are tuning the theory from Hartree-Fock to pure DFT. If you use alpha equal one, the theme you are using here are exactly Hartree-Fock with function. At alpha equal one, every hybrid is pure Hartree-Fock. So, the wave function you are putting
is it's still a DFT. It's still DFT in orbitals. They're never connected.
In the exalt exchange approach, yes, but in the hybrids, in which you really take the expression for the exchange as.
Consistently,
Francesco,
this
would be the same. Yes, I mean, okay, you remove everything from the LDA.
Yeah, so that's the alpha equal to one.
Okay, no, I don't see the green over what is right.
Okay. But he didn't write the alpha. He said if alpha is equal to one, basically there's no LDA, it's just alpha.
Okay, yes, in self-consistency. Yes, at self-consistency.
So in the hybrid, you use as exchange this operator, which is no local, sum over OJ, on the occupied state. So this is exactly the Fock operator of Hartree-Fock. Can you?
Yes.
And what you do is that you build your functional as alpha sigma x minus plus one minus alpha, no? The Vx of LDA, say, or PBE, plus BC PBE. Something like this, no? This can be a fine PBAH function. You adjust your alpha. So if you put alpha equal one, you take as exchange pure Hartree-Fock exchange. And you add just only a log apart correlation part, which is almost negligible. And this part is zero, one minus one is zero. You can move from Hartree-Fock to full PBE. Alpha equal zero is full PBE. the wave function that you obtain goes from RTFOC to PB, continuous wave. So you can never, I would say that, in fact, the EXA DFT theory, Consham theory, okay, say that this is a theory that was made to have the EXA total energy, the EXA electronic density with the Consham potential, V Consham, which is local. In the exact way, in the exact theory, this function is local. Here, I'm using a local, not a prime, it's a local potential that I know just only on helium, okay? But it's local, and this potential is able to give me this total energy. So it exists a local, no need to introduce the locality. No need to introduce an omega dB.
Exchange correlation potential is non-local.
Sorry?
The exchange correlation potential is non-local.
No, no, no. This is local. This is local. I can show you omega cones. I have to plot it. So they have found the potential, which is V of R. V of R. And this potential has the right 1 over R Q. 1 over R cubed, so it goes like 1 over R. Take this paper of Umbrigan, and it is there, and it's compared with the LDA, the PB, the GA, other functionals, and you can see what how they differ. So this extra potential goes like 1 over R for R going to infinity, like it must go, while LDA and PB are exponentially dark. So they die much before. And then also it goes to a finite at zero, it goes to a finite value, like LDA, more or less, while PB present an affinitical divergence. So you see that PBGGA is less physical than LDA. And that DB also present some strange oscillation here, while these are absent in the exact exchange correlation potential. So there is a VX of L, which is local. You have found it, Giamatto?
Okay. Yes, but, I mean, the VXC is rho, and rho, I think it's rho everywhere.
No, this is the VXC of R. So is the VXC of R corresponding to helium? So yes. Corresponding to the rho of helium. We know.
Sorry,
this is an important point. So we did see, I go to your question.
Maybe because of the reverse engineering that we have the prior knowledge of the density, that's why we can have a form of V, no? And this is what...
I made this point more precise. So V Consham XC exact which assist is a functional of rho and the function of R. Okay. So it's common. We don't know if we know the VXC except VXC as functional of rho, the problem is solved for DFT and even for TDFT. This we don't know, but we know this VXC of R, okay, in one case only or other model case, which is helium. So in the case of helium, we know of the density and the mix, the density of R, and the VXC of R, and it's only just one case. So this means in terms of function analysis, if you do it, so this is functional analysis, no? Yeah. Functional is a function of a function, okay? So we know a functional at just only one point, but just only one function. It's like to know a function f of x at just only one x zero. How can you reconstruct the full fx knowing the function just only have fx of zero? So if we know at several other points, it's impossible to reconstruct the function. You can do an interpolation, whatever, but the real function is still keeps unknown. The same for a function. So we know the functional at one point. We are far from the exact analytic functional dependence of rho.
So for you, generalized consumption schemes are not DFT.
If you, hello, I answer like Walter Cohn had answered. When I saw developments of DFT tower non-local consumption potential, they said this is not anymore my theory. Because indeed, let's say the importance of the discovery of Cohn was to see that it is possible to do a many body theory, which gives you the exact total energy, all the ground state properties, by using just only one local potential. It's even easier than Hartree-Fock. Okay, this is the important. He considered his discovery important from the modest person he was. By consider importance of the fact that it's still a local theory, so it could be solvable. If your consumption potential keeps local, so it, in my opinion, it is within DFT, and Cohn will consider it as its own child. If you go toward non-locality, of course, the important introduction was to, let's say, to not have any more to do with non-local Hartree-Fock or non-local theories. So you can call generalized consumption. Then if we ask Cohn where still alive, I don't know if the answer, I know that he participated to a, you know that every year there is a general DFT conference. And when people, Andreas Görlin presented some developments toward a non-local consumption potential, he raised the hand and this, Walter Cohn raised the hand and said, but why are you doing that? My great let's say point was to have just only have one local potential, and this gives you the a lot of exact quantities ready. Okay, it's a matter, at this point it's a matter of opinion, so you can keep your opinion. Okay, if there are no any more questions, time for lunch.